Welcome, everybody, to the fourth episode of From Hereford to Here, which is an independent look at everything to do with Brighton, Hove, Albion Football Club, introduced and hosted by myself, Attila the Stockbroker, otherwise known as John Bain, poet, musician, and lifelong Albion fan. Every week I have a free bar, which is always a good idea, and I have a special guest. And my special guest this week is somebody who I first met as a very angry young teenager on the terraces and elsewhere at Brighton, Hove, Albion in the 1990s as one of our most dedicated campaigners in the long battle to save our club from oblivion. And now he is Chief of Media at Brighton, Hove, Albion. Please welcome my old mate, Paul Camillin.
Hi, John. Good to see you.
What would you like to drink?
I'm driving, so I've got to stay on the soft stuff, but I'll go for a lemonade, I think.
OK, mate. Well, I shall have a beer, as I always do. So, right, so, Paul, just tell us the history of your involvement with the club from day one.
Well, day one was as a fan, I guess. First went to the Goldstone. I genuinely can't remember the first game. So I've been going for a while, and I couldn't tell you. I was that young. First game I remember, Cup replay 86 against Peterborough. We'd drawn at London Road in the snow.
Yeah, I remember that. Ball bounced up off the...
Well, I don't remember that game. I just remember...
Errington Kelly.
Going to the replay and the Albion winning 1-0. And then, it was just a fan, really, for a number of years. Bouncing around those sort of mid divisions, if you like. Old second division, third division. Remember the 88 promotion campaign under Barry Lloyd, winning at the Goldstone against Bristol Rovers. Playoff year where we obviously lost at Wembley to Notts County. And then as you got older, obviously, we got worse to the point where we obviously... The Goldstone ground was sold in 95.
When can you first remember actually getting involved in the campaign?
So probably just... I can remember there used to be a group of us that would hang around outside the West Stand after most home games.
Were you in the North Stand then?
Or? Yeah, so I'd have been in the North Stand. Yeah. And then there was a group of us, very small group, who would basically hang around to heckle Bellotti and... obviously not Stanley and Archer because they were never there.
But, yeah, sure.
Heckle Bellotti as he left.
Yeah, he was the patsy. For anyone who doesn't, anyone who wasn't old enough to remember or wasn't around then, Bellotti was the patsy.
Yeah.
So Archer and Stanley were the people responsible for the disaster. Bellotti was the patsy who was paid to take the flak.
So that season, and then I can remember sort of gradually, the guys in the A21 club started travelling to away games with them and. Meeting people like Adrian Newnham, Paul, yourself, going to the Beezer meetings at Southwick and at the Concord Club down on the seafront.
Monday night, Concord Club.
Obviously remember the famous one where Harty sort of virtually bullied Greg Stanley into saying we would stay at the Goldstone.
The Goldstone ground will be sold over my dead body.
Which wasn't quite true as it panned out, but sort of almost... said you've got to say something here tonight because otherwise you're going to have a riot on your hands. And we obviously stayed that extra season, and I think even then we knew it was a stay of execution. There was no way we were staying there. Hereford,
and
then obviously those horrendous 2 years at
and
Gillingham.
It was at Gillingham when you first started getting. Tell me how you first started getting involved with the club.
So I think the club left the Goldstone, and I think Bellotti had booted out Tony Millard, who was doing the programme, taking the programme to the guys down at Bishop's in Portsmouth, who ironically now print the programme as well. But in this day and age, really good guys, they print a lot of football programmes. But Bellotti had sort of taken it down there without realising the deal that he'd done was just to print the programme. So they didn't have a programme editor. Mm. So the guys in the print shop down at Bishop's literally had to produce the club's programme. So I think when Dick took over, they didn't have a programme editor. We were doing a fanzine called Scars and Stripes in those days, and I'd sent a letter to Dick just with some ideas in terms of this is what we could do at the football club, get the fans involved, tap into that, which we did for years. You know, Dick, Martin Perry, Nick Rowe in those days used to utilise the fans as a resource.
Well,
they had to because they didn't have the financial resources. So, and it was really through that. So. Did 2-3 years as a freelancer.
So you became you started doing the programme freelance in
in 98. So we started the last season at Gillingham.
Yeah, so well, you started doing the programme about the same time as I started. Yeah. We started doing the PA. Although we were doing the PA, actually.
I think you'd started from the beginning. Already.
We started about the third game. Yeah. Me and Paul Sam were doing the PA.
Yeah, because I can remember those first couple of games with the guy that did it for Gillingham. Yeah,
his name was Dougie.
Lovely he runs
a folk club in Gillingham, and he's a Gillingham PA announcer. He's a Gillingham fan.
Please
welcome Brighton No Albion. So it was at that point, I said to Dick, who I'm standing next to on the terrace, you know, Dick, I could do better than that. And he said, well, go on then, John. I said, well, be punk, ska and reggae and a Phil Collins band and a bit of poetry. He went, that's all right. So then we started.
Well, and that second season, I remember I'd travel up regularly with Ian Hart, driving up from Worthing. Richard Gander, a mate of ours, would share the driving with us, and Hartie would do the phone in on BBC Sussex, and then we'd obviously drive back together. So obviously saw a lot of you and Paul in those days, because you were right next to the...
Well, the funny thing was, I've never said this, it is in my book actually a little bit, but the PA thing was really funny to start off with, because it was a way to get to Gillingham. So the first couple of games, got there early, had five pints in the Rose Neath, and then got to the match.
I don't think you were ever sober.
Well, that's just the point. Well, I mean, when Dick asked me to do the PA, all I did was put the five pints back a bit. So I was actually, you know, I was doing the PA after five or six pints most weeks. And of course, one of the things about that is, I mean, I'm a performer, I could do a reasonably good job and I'm playing the records and everything, but I think if you had five or six pints, you need to have a wee. And I couldn't just leave the box. And it was because of that I first asked Paul Sandra to come in with me. And I'm thinking, I need somebody who's a bit more sensible. And, you know, so when I need a wee break, I can go off and have one. That was it. That's how it started. But it's just for people that have come to the club much later, through not being there because they weren't born or not older, or because they've come to the club and started supporting us now we're in the Premier League for other reasons. I mean, it is an incredible thing going back to thinking about the times when we were the infrastructure of the club. There was Dick, and then it was you doing the programme, me doing the PA. Yeah. We're all volunteers, you know, more or less. I mean, I never got paid for it.
Absolutely. I mean, they were good times, though. But, you know, you had some really good people there.
Absolutely.
Derek Callan in the offices, Sally Townsend, Edward David, you know, people that were Ian Carpenter, who's sort of retired now. Derek's obviously semi-retired. Edward's semi-retired, Sally's semi-retired, but it's great they're still involved at the club. Absolutely. You know, real heroes, kept the club going. And some of them took a fair bit of abuse as well, because they were keeping the club going when Bellotti was there, you know, but could see that, you know, tickets still had to be sold, the club still had to be run.
I think we all realised that the difference between the people who were actively involved in the destruction of the club and those who were simply just doing a job.
And some great stories that they can tell you that, you know, I think naming those four, you'll probably be hard pushed to find four that would have disliked him more than us. But absolutely, those four certainly would, because they were, you know, at the forefront
of everything.
Deal with him every day, and they could see the damage that was being done. So,
But moving forward, so when did you actually become? When was your first?
So I think when we got promoted after that first championship with Dean, and that was a great moment because you know, we'd had all that.
All the
dross and terrible football. And I think back to some of the games at Gillingham, like the Doncaster game, 6,000 turn up, and still the worst game of football. I mean, it wasn't even a game of football.
Well, the second Fans United day, you mean, don't the heart of football?
Yeah, so...
Donny had a goalkeeper who was about 45 and was about that big. And they could still be playing now, and it would be 0-0.
Absolutely,
ineptitude was at a level that was. It should have got. They should have got an Arts Council grant for ineptitude.
But yeah, so I mean, that's after all of that, to have that championship under Mickey Adams.
Absolutely, Zamora,
Bobby Zamora, obviously coming in and doing what he did. Mm. But that team, and I can remember standing that night when we won the game against Chesterfield. I never had a seat with Dean, apart from the first season. But that second season, I'd just stand behind the press box with Chris Cannon, who was the press steward, because we didn't have enough seats for the press.
So when did you actually start? When did you take
that
up the
summer?
The press officer role.
Martin Perry, I think, said to Dick, look, we need to. There's loads we need to do here in terms of press, website. Websites were coming into the fore then. I mean, social media and apps were a long way in the future, but the website was growing. And so they said, can you come and work for us full time that summer? Which obviously,
What were you doing before for a job?
Well, I was freelancing, bits of graphic design, journalism, writing, doing bits for various football magazines, papers, had a column in the Argus, that sort of stuff. I was earning a decent living. And before that, I'd been working just at Lloyd's in Worthing, registrars, with the funny story there was Paul Hazelwood, who's now the club photographer, was actually my boss at Lloyd's.
Right.
So, and Paul got involved in the sports photography at around the same time, and you know, you look at his stuff now, he's gone on to be an amazing photographer.
Oh, yeah, brilliant.
And he's, you know, he's documented that era of Brighton history, of going from With Dean to the new stadium, getting promotion to the Premier League, that first season in the Premier League. You know, Paul's got it all.
Got a corporate comfort break now, so see you in a minute. So what's it like? What's the difference between being the press officer out of a porter cabin at With Dean and in our wonderful new stadium?
In all honesty, it's not actually that different, but you are, the principles of the job are the same, but you're obviously doing it to a much wider audience, to a much bigger scale.
Is your workload more? I mean, are you actually doing more per day?
In fairness, there's a team of us now.
Yeah, sure.
So there's a media team of
so it's probably actually easier in some ways.
A lot of it's just, I hate to say this, but some of it's just delegating stuff to people saying we need to get that done. But I think we're still seen as one of the clubs that opens its door to the media, gives access to the people that matter, you know, and gets our story out there. We've got a great story. You know, what we've talked about there, the global media, the national media and the local media.
Yeah, this is one of the things I was going to say to you, Paul. I think we're doing it. I'll just say we need to continue to do this. You know, hopefully we're going to be in the Premier League for years to come. And we need for everybody to keep knowing about where we've come from. Because, I mean, this is happening so much.
I think that that's our unique thing.
It's happening in football generally now. There are so many predatory moneymen coming in to try and take stadia off people, turn them into, you know, shopping malls or whatever, destroy clubs. That is happening so much. We stand as an example of people who fought back, and we've got this wonderful reputation now because of that. I mean, you know, the documentaries and the bits that were done just before the start of the first season in the Premier League. You know, it's an amazing story.
We need to keep that going. I think that, you know, serves as a, you know, we hear it all the time, you know, people look at us, look at our story, look at what we've achieved, and if Brighton can do it, anybody can do it. And I think that's true. I think if you've got you need certain things, and don't get me wrong, we've been incredibly, incredibly lucky to have Tony Bloom to come in and obviously finance what we've done. But he's also done it very sensibly. You know, you talk about other owners, obviously with tragic events at Leicester, but if you look at what's been done there, it's also been done in a similar way, very much with the Leicester community at the heart.
Absolutely, you need
to,
if you're going.
And do you know what's really sad with that? It only really comes to the fore when the guy tragically died in the helicopter crash. But, you know, we learnt so many of these brilliant gestures that he'd done to the Leicester community. It was only when he died that it really took on that global and national story. But absolutely, you know, people love that sort of tale from underdog to...
I knew something of that because obviously what I do for a living, travelling around doing gigs, when I play in Leicester,
to actually get it out there to the masses, as I said, it took the owner actually dying for people to know about that story on a proper level, you know.
So how much do you have much autonomy in terms of what you do? I mean, can you
pretty much? Yeah.
Can you determine what stories are put out to the media? Are you fed stuff, or do you create it?
Not really. I mean, certain things we'll create and we'll say let's why don't we talk to so and so about this subject? Sometimes the media will come and say, you know, can we talk to Matt Ryan about his love of tennis because it's out there and they know about it. And yeah, I mean, we're pretty open to doing most things. I think the media are pretty trustworthy as well. There's this sort of feeling that, oh, you know, we've got to control that. We've got to give somebody the corporate line to spew out. But actually, you just let the lads' own personalities come through, and that's the best way of doing it. Some of them are nervous in front of the camera, don't like doing it, and I won't name names, but and then other players quite happy to do it.
If somebody doesn't want to do it, are they sort of
force them. Yeah, you know, sure. It is, and some people
it's
say,
obvious that Glenn's not terribly sort of happy doing it too much. I mean,
no, he loves it.
He loves it, doesn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, Glenn, right, Glenn's right. A huge fan of right, doing it, and right. he's done a huge amount of late. So no, Glenn's one right. who's really
he's quite
happy
quiet,
to be in front of them.
Yeah.
No, but I think do you know what I think's really interesting with Glenn is he's if you ask him a good question, you'll get a good answer. If you ask him a real closed question that's a yes or, you know, do you like scoring goals, Glenn?
Yeah, sure.
You're just going to get yes.
Who's the most sort of, would you say, the most articulate? If you're not allowed to say
that,
do you know
the one who I always love doing press? So sitting up and being the one that's speaking was Steve Sidwell. And
right.
I can remember Siddy when he was 18, 19, coming on loan from Arsenal. And he was the finished article then. And I can remember people saying, oh, he's been so well media trained. He wasn't well media trained. He just came from a really good stock. You know, he spoke about it recently when he retired. You know, his dad used to take him out on the building sites when he was a kid in the school holidays. So he sort of saw the other side of life.
Absolutely.
You know, he wasn't this sort of, yes, he was in a great environment at Arsenal, but he saw the other side of life.
That's one of the key things. That's why I was so impressed with someone like Craig McHale Smith, for instance. When you've got people that come in who haven't had the full right from six in some academy,
Glenn
and they've
Murray.
actually played in non-league football.
Well,
Glenn
Murray played non-league football, worked as a plasterer.
Absolutely, yeah.
Drove round the US playing in the second tier then, or what was effectively the second tier with the Wilmington Hammerheads.
Yeah,
you know, sounds like one of your bands, John.
it's those players, the ones who've actually really who realise how lucky it is. I always say, you know, I've earned my living doing what I love my entire life, and that is a real privilege. And I relate to the players who recognise what a privilege it is.
Players.
And when you see someone who's not trying, or obviously,
I like what Matt Ryan said after our game at Liverpool this season, where he said we've got a no what's its policy, and I think that's right. I think that's testament to the recruitment that's done, and I think you'd very quickly get chewed up and spat out from that dressing room if you turned up and you were. If you did have those sort of delusions of grandeur, you know, and what have
I'm
you.
I'm wondering how Leon Knight would get on these days.
now, see, Leon, I don't agree with anything Leon says in terms of his social media feed, but Leon was great for us when he was at the club in terms of from a media point of view. Whenever you asked him to do anything, responsible, always did it, or never a problem. And I wouldn't say towed the line, because we never made players toe the line as such, but Leon was never a problem until, obviously, towards the end where the goals dried up. And I think if Leon was honest with himself, probably wasn't doing what he needed to do in training Monday to Friday, and that might be why the goals dried up. But let's not forget the contribution he made in that season.
Well, absolutely.
And a season that was instrumental because of what we did at the Millennium Stadium in terms of turning John Prescott's head to see... Albion can put 30,000 bumps
absolutely.
On seats.
That was a big part of the campaign to get the new stadium.
Well, we do it every week now, you know, here in Brighton, which is fantastic. But don't forget, you know, people were questioning at that point, why do Brighton need a 30,000-seater stadium? They can't even fill with Dean.
Well, I mean, I'd always say to them, you know, I remember going to a Tuesday night game and playing Rochdale at home in 1972, 73, whenever it was, you know, 27,000 people there. The fan base was always here. It was just simply a question of...
I think we've now sold out every game in the Premier League from a home perspective. Home game has sold out at the Amex, which is, you know, it just goes to show. People used to say when Brighton were in the First Division before, the results changed and the team weren't winning as much and therefore people didn't come. But the same's true now. You know, we're not winning as much as we were in the Championship, but people still come.
It's a different. We talked about this in previous editions of this thing that I'm doing, which is the difference between being, you know, a club in a league where you've got basically pretty much a level playing field where everybody can beat everybody else, and we can just go out and be fairly sort of just go for it. In one way, there's an, it really is obviously there has to be an element of damage limitation because the top. you know, the top few clubs have got so much more resources. And I mean, I've accepted that. I mean, you know,
but you've got to gradually try and do what Leicester have done.
Yeah, I know.
You know,
and, I mean, I've accepted it now. I wouldn't. I've said this many times. Totally happy with it now from where we've come. I wouldn't like to think that for the rest of my life, if I maybe have got another 20 years, I wouldn't like to spend all the next 20 years celebrating finishing 16th in the table, you know.
No, but then if you look at the clubs that have done that, the Stokes, the Southamptons, they've had cup finals, they've had European adventures. Yeah. So it's not just about that. And I think we've got a chairman, genuinely, who always wants to see, you know, even if we're progressing by that much instead of that much,
absolutely,
we want to progress. We want to move on, you know, and try and get into. I mean, our next challenge is to compete with the, you know, Leicester are almost below that top six. Watford are just below that top six. You know, having really good seasons again. Both had really good. I mean, obviously Leicester won the league not so long ago. I'm not saying that we're gonna win the league.
No, but I mean that was an incredible thing, and it did, you know, made a lot of.
Yeah, again, like our story, fantastic story, and you know, it might be a cup, it might be a European run. Who knows? I'm not sure we're ready yet. I think we still need to establish ourselves in the.
Talking of the story, one thing I was going to say to you, and this is something for you to put to the powers that be, if you think it's a fair point. I do think that the museum should be open on match days for everybody. I don't think it should be part
of a
stadium tour.
It's a difficult one because
it's such an essential part of our history.
But it's a difficult one because of the Dirk's Bar and getting people into the museum. So. I think it did used to open earlier on a match day, and
if there could be another entrance for it, so people could go in there without having come into Dick's Bar first, so that small children or younger people could come in.
Yeah, I mean,
I do think that it's such an easy way to show our new supporters our past. Anyway, I think we're coming to the end now. So, Paul, thank you very, very much. It's been very enjoyable.
Great to see you.
And
thanks,
all
John.
The very best.
Cheers.